Good morning, colleagues, and welcome to the 8th meeting in 2017 of the Finance and Constitution Committee. As usual, can you put your mobile phones and tablets, etc., in a mode that won't interfere with the processes this morning? The first item on our agenda is to take evidence on the Air Departure Tax Scotland Bill at Stage 1, and it's intended to allow the committee the opportunity to put questions on the bill to the Cabinet Secretaries and officials. A welcome to the meeting, Derek Mackay, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Constitution. Mr. Mackay is joined by Scottish Government officials. I welcome them back. James McLellan, the Head of Devolved Taxes, John St. Clair, the Senior Principal Legal Officer, and Mike Stewart, the Bill Manager. Welcome to the meeting. Mr. Mackay, I would invite you to make an opening statement.
Hey, thank you, Convener. Thank you for the opportunity to make an opening statement on the Air Departure Tax Scotland Bill. The devolution of air passenger duty was recommended by the Smith Commission following the passage of the Scotland Act 2016, and the Scottish Parliament now has the power to legislate for a tax which will replace APD in Scotland. In the programme for government, the Scottish Government announced that a bill would be introduced to establish a tax to replace APD in Scotland, and it also reaffirmed the Scottish Government's commitment to delivering a 50% reduction in the overall burden of ADT by the end of this Parliament, and to abolishing the tax when resources allow. The Scottish Government has taken a consultative approach to engaging stakeholders on the replacement for APD, and we published a policy consultation last year which generated a range of views, and we've worked carefully to refine our legislative proposals reflecting on the responses received. In addition to this, we established a stakeholder forum which I chair to provide expert input into the development of our policy and legislative proposals for ADT. I've also been listening to the responses to the committee that you've received, Stage 1 call for evidence, and I'd like to take this opportunity to thank all those who have contributed to a thoughtful and thorough discussion of the issues so far. The committee has taken evidence from a range of different stakeholders, and the government will reflect carefully on all the points which have been raised. As the committee is aware, the bill was introduced on the 19th of December 2016. Under terms agreed between the Scottish and UK governments in the fiscal framework, APD will cease to apply in Scotland from 1st of April 2018, and if this bill is enacted, ADT will replace it from that date. The bill establishes the general structure and operation of ADT. The bill also includes a power for Scottish ministers to set tax exemptions, tax rate amounts and bans through secondary legislation. Subject to parliamentary approval, the Scottish Government hopes to pass the bill in advance of the summer recess, and with core foundations of the tax in place, will then bring forward tax rate amounts and tax bans through secondary legislation in the autumn. This secondary legislation will be subject to the affirmative procedure, meaning Parliament will have the opportunity to scrutinise the proposals at a later date, and they cannot come into effect without Parliament's approval. Setting tax bans and tax rate amounts in subordinate legislation is consistent with the approach adopted in relation to other devolved taxes in Scotland. The Scottish Government is considering all exemptions for ADT in the round, together with options on tax bans and tax rate amounts. I've listened to the environmental concerns that have been raised by some respondents, and the Scottish Government is committed to undertaking a full strategic environmental assessment. And as an example of good practice, openness and transparency, the screening scoping report was made available for full public comment. The SEA process will continue to develop as the policy proposals are further developed. An environmental report setting out the findings of the assessment will be published and made available for comment alongside the policy proposals as part of the next phase of the SEA process. More widely, the recently published draft climate change plan sets out how the Scottish Government proposes to meet the statutory emission reduction targets under the Climate Change Scotland Act 2009. These targets, which have been set at levels recommended by the Committee on Climate Change, comprises all emissions across the Scottish economy, including both domestic and international aviation. Revenue Scotland, Scotland's tax authority for devolved taxes, will be responsible for the collection and management of ADT, and it has been, as it has been since April 1st, 2015, for LBTT and Scottish landfill tax. The Scottish Fiscal Commission will assume responsibility for developing a model of ADT, and once the policy position has been set out, will produce independent forecasts of revenues to inform the Scottish Government's draft budget 2018-19. So I look forward to answering the committee's questions this morning.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I know some of my colleagues will get into the specifics of the detail of the bill itself, although I think it's fair for me to open up on a question around the issue of evidence on the government's policy, because there's a lot of comment being made in evidence to the committee previously about that, both by the airline industry and environmental groups who've talked about the lack of the evidence base with regard to the Scottish Government's stated aim of a 50% reduction in the level of ADT within the current parliamentary term, particularly in regard to economic and environmental issues. I heard what you said in your opening address, and I note you make reference also in your letter of the 24th of February in regard to the impact of emissions on 50% reduction. Nevertheless, how would you respond to that wide-ranging criticism about the lack of evidence that's currently available?
Evidence specifically on the environmental concerns.
Environmental and economic assessment.
Okay. Well, I think that, you know, there are a number of reports out there, and there's a great deal of evidence, and you can draw your own conclusions from each piece of evidence on what it might mean. But I suppose I can hone in on what, in terms of what we understand, that this being one of the highest taxes of its kind in the world, and certainly the highest in Europe, so self-evident there is an issue in that tax. When our agencies engage with airlines and airports, they inform us that it is a key consideration when airlines are looking where to establish routes. So in attracting economic growth and new routes, it's a consideration, a key consideration in which destinations airlines would go to, and does seem to be, from that evidence, that information, that experience, a barrier to Scotland developing new routes. And there's been some success in some Scottish airports, Edinburgh and Glasgow, for example. Some are in a less strong position, haven't enjoyed the same growth, Aberdeen, for example. So the experience coming from the airports is that APD has had an impact, does have an impact in attracting and sustaining routes. In terms of the reports, and as I say, a number of reports have been published, there is something of a consensus around the economic benefits that would come from a 50% reduction, some consistency around that. And then if we go beyond, well, what would a policy change look like? Two operators in particular have identified how they believe that they would then allocate routes in future. I would reference EasyJet and Ryanair, who have both said they would increase capacity if there was a change in the tax by way of a reduction 50% cut. So I suppose that's the different pieces of evidence that I'll draw from. What has been published, what operators tell us has been the experience, the airports tell us has been the experience, what would assist us in our economic case, and what would improve our international connectivity, recognising the rate of this tax across Europe and then more widely. Further to that, the World Economic Forum's identified air links as an important driver of global competitiveness. On the environmental side, obviously there has to be more work done around the specifics of the policy. I mean, this stage is the enabling legislation to allow us to collect the tax. More detail comes from the tax rates and bans. And from that, more information around what the impact of that would be would require that strategic environmental assessment, which would have to consider those matters and then publish the evidence specifically on what the policy would look like for rates and bans. But again, looking at the government's ambitious environmental policies, it's recognised that we will have to work harder in other areas to recognise that such a policy could lead to an increase in emissions. But putting those emissions into context, as I understand it, an increase of 3% in aviation emissions would be 0.1% in the total Scottish emissions. But there's a recognition that that is an increase, and therefore there has to be efforts in other areas based on that evidence that it has an environmental impact. So there can be environmental studies into the generic policy, but then more detail following on from the rates and bans, because that, I think that gives more clarity on what the environmental impact and indeed what the economic output would be from that.
Okay, obviously we're dealing with the principle just now of whether there should be a tax or not. I understand that. But can you give us any understanding of what the timescales might be? First of all, I want to come back to the economic stuff, but in terms of the strategic environmental assessment, Can you give us any details of the timescales when you think that might be forthcoming? Because obviously, as the statutory instrument emerges around these, if and when it does, that will be a key determiner about for committee members about whether the evidence then exists to examine the statutory instrument at that time.
No, that's right, Convener. I think we have to have that information on the SEA as we're setting the tax policy. So, Mike, could you cover the timescales in that to building up to that determination?
Yep. Firstly, the remaining step of the SEA process is to publish an environmental report as well as a set of proposals from the government on the tax banding and tax rate amounts over a 12-week period for public consultation. So that's a statutory part of the SEA process. That process, that consultation process, must be concluded and a reasonable amount of time allowed after that conclusion before the secondary legislation for the tax rate, the tax bands and tax rate amounts could be laid before Parliament. The government's plans, I think, are obviously, as the Cabinet Secretary said, to set out the tax bands and tax rate amounts in secondary legislation. So that will follow enactment of the bill. So most likely we would probably be laying those secondary legislation sometime in the autumn. So working back from that with a sort of 12-week process, that would mean that the SEA consultation, as I say, I wouldn't be in a position to give exact timings, but most likely before the bill was before summer recess, most likely.
Yeah, but at least 12 weeks before the statutory instrument came into being, or was brought before Parliament.
Yes, plus a reasonable amount of time has to be allowed after the conclusion of that consultation as well, to enable the government to take on board any feedback that comes in. Because as with most consultations, most of the responses obviously tend to come in right at the end of a consultation period.
Okay, let me deal with the economic impact assessment now. I mean, obviously the committee members are aware that there's been a number of pieces of work done by either the airports or the airline operators about what their view is of this. But has the government itself actually undertaken any economic assessment of the impact of reduction to 50%?
Our officials have certainly looked at all the reports and considered them. We haven't commissioned, to the best of my knowledge, any independent research of our own, but we've certainly looked at all the reports that have been published and provided, as well, of course, as the experience in Ireland as well.
Would you commit yourself today then to carrying out that independent assessment of the economic case?
If committee wishes me to look at that, I'll certainly consider that, absolutely. And I think that, again, I want to make the point, Convener, that this is the enabling legislation to allow us to collect the tax. Obviously, a key stage is at what levels we set the tax. And that is the consideration of that will probably tell us much more about environmental and economic impact on that. So, if committee wishes me to consider that as one of your recommendations, yes, I'll consider that.
Well, I think that's probably highly likely that we'll do that, but obviously we'll not get to considering a report for a couple of weeks yet. But okay, that's a helpful beginning. Ivan, I think you had issues around the economic issue.
Yeah, I wanted to drill further into this, and I suppose it might be difficult to go further because what you're saying is you don't have an independent economic assessment at this stage. I was wanting to kind of go in a bit more detail on that. I suppose I'm starting from the position that clearly one of the aims of the 50% reduction specifically was to generate more economic activity, and obviously to is believed that it would also generate that would give more money back into the public sector finances as a consequence. And there's some analysis we've seen from Edinburgh Airport, from bigger economics on that. I was wanting to go a step further and say, if you look at the range of different types of routes, different types of passengers, clearly some of those have got a much higher impact on potential economic growth than others may have. Okay, inbound tourism clearly is preferable to outbound tourism, depending on medium haul, long haul, may give different economic benefits depending on where the routes are going. Business passengers clearly would give an economic benefit perhaps than tourism, etc. So have you looked at segmentation in that sense, and
which of those segments would give the most economic benefit, and as a consequence, tailoring the tax in order to enable that, encourage that to happen? Or is it very much just a blanket view of the thing that says we're going to make the change in the hope that it stimulates economic activity across the board?
No, I think it's the case that we absolutely would want to refine the policy in the next stage of rates and bands to what helps us achieve the government's economic strategy, which clearly will have to adapt to the circumstances, you know, the changed European outlook, for example, connectivity, how our business opportunities, tourist opportunities have changed as well. So we, in terms of the report, the question that was asked by the convener was, had we as a government commissioned our own independent survey? No, we haven't, but we've looked at all the other pieces of work that's in the public domain and who's commissioned them and who they were for and the summary of each report. So all of that can feed into, once we have the power and the ability to collect the tax, how we arrive at the decisions around the rates and the bands. And so there's of course environmental issues within that, and there's the economic opportunities, but the government's economic message being around Scotland being open for business, also supporting tourism, wanting strong connectivity, believing that airports are drivers for economy. Many members around this table understand how airports can be a driver for the economy. Our messages around connectivity, you know, strengthening our position in Europe, all of these things would feature in that next stage of what gives us economic benefit. And then the economic, frankly, the spending plans of the government as well. So how it ties in with all of that is a matter for future consideration. And of course, we would look at how any reduction in the tax should be applied and distributed.
Right, so...
But I'm not prejudicing that this morning, convener. As I say, this is for me the foundations of the legislation to enable us to collect the tax.
Okay,
that's not putting out in the public domain what our proposal is, because that's yet to be determined.
No, that's clear. So just to be clear, you will look at the data. You will consider segmentation depending on what different segments of that market might generate the most economic stimulus, and then that will come back for consideration at the next future stage.
Of course. Okay.
James.
Thank you, convener. I think it is disappointing that you're bringing forward a major piece of legislation and the government hasn't conducted its own research and assessment on it. I know your comments that you'll await the committee's recommendation on that, but just to, you know, to go on a specific, in preparing for the bill to bring it forward, had you given any consideration, for example, to the impact of Brexit?
Well, that's certainly a consideration as to how you would apply the reduction or how you would set rates and bands. So, of course, that I think that that's a helpful point to show how putting everything in primary legislation wouldn't necessarily be the appropriate thing to do, because the world is changing, routes are changing, operations are changing, politics are changing, budgetary considerations. So the same way that in our other taxes, I think we have to be quite flexible and adept. Of course, those kind of international connections issues would feature in a policy going forward, naturally.
Does that mean you're reconsidering your policy intent to reduce the size of the tax by 50%?
The policy intent was to reduce the tax by 50% and then abolish when resources allow. That 50% reduction was over the course of the Parliament. So the policy intent has not changed. How that reduction is distributed is still to be determined.
Well, so, I mean, you're saying it's enabling legislation, but you're setting out a clear policy intent there, which is going to have substantial impact, and therefore it is important that there's robust research that backs that up. Just on, you know, again going back to the Brexit point, Parliament debated Brexit yesterday and there was a concern coming out of the economy report that the impact of Brexit would have an adverse effect on poor and elderly households. Is it a consideration that potentially that by reducing what's going to be collected by this tax. That would adversely affect, it would benefit families who, you know, are able to afford flights, but adversely affect poor and elderly households, as underlined by the Economy Committee of the Parliament.
I think a wider point, Mr Kelly, is the one that you're making around the wider spending plans of the government. So I'm not dismissing that, but what I'm saying around Brexit is it makes the point around international connectivity, and we want to ensure, you know, post-Brexit vote, that it's clear Scotland has a desire to remain connected to the world, and we also believe that connectivity is important for economic growth as well, and business growth, and clearly business organisations support this position as well. But you're right, there is a public expenditure point in all of this as well, but there's that international connectivity, there's the engagement with Europe, and there are the decisions to be taken around the tax rates and how that's distributed, but yes, within the financial envelope. So all of these matters have to be considered when we approach the tax rates and bans. But we should be careful. Again, I'm making the point, I'm not avoiding the policy intent questions, but that's not what I'm asking you to determine this morning.
Murdo, you wanted a supplementary on this, but...
Yeah, just a couple of brief points. I mean, first of all, to follow up from what Ivan was saying about the economic impact, I think the evidence we've heard, both for and against a reduction, has been quite poor, and I think it'd be very useful when you bring forward the orders to have that backed up with a proper economic analysis. Mm-hmm. And I just want to reinforce the points we made earlier about how helpful I think the committee would find that if that was... it was possible for that to be done. The real question I wanted to ask was around timing. I understand your policy commitment is to see a 50% reduction by the end of the Parliament. Is there anything more you can say today about when you would intend to bring that reduction in?
No, I think that's premature. I'm making the point that today, establishing the legislation allows us to collect the tax. That we have to do. Then there's further discussion to be had around what a reduction looks like and how it fits within an economic plan, how it fits within our connectivity ambitions and environmental considerations. Well, all of that should be taken together. Now, clearly there is evidence from Ireland and what they did around abolishing the tax and the impact that that had there. But we should be able to look at all of this evidence, everything that currently exists and what we're trying to achieve as a country and our economic strategy as well. I think it's fair to say that we have to return to Parliament with the evidence around this and specifically what our preferred approach, our proposal, would be trying to achieve, and does that make economic and environmental sense. So we have a broad policy intent. How you refine that into essentially the tax proposition to be considered, we will return to Parliament with that, having established the ability to raise the tax. And certainly, the more information it's produced to support that case, the better. I get that point, and I commit to doing that.
OK, thank you. And just so we're clear on timing, you say it'll be the autumn that you introduce the instruments. That's your planned timescale at present, and at that point you'll produce all the evidence to go along with it.
That's correct.
OK.
But in advance of that, as has been set out, we will publish the SEA that speaks specifically to the tax options.
Okay, I'm just going to get a couple of questions around the wider issues of the economy and the environment, and then I'm going to come to Patrick on some of the specifics around the policy content and link to the bill. Now, if I've got this right, Neil, you had a wider economic question about the policy, as we've been discussing already.
Yeah,
I think then Marie had a question around the wider environmental issues, and then I'll come to Patrick.
Well, just to follow up, really on the question that James Kelly was asking about the impact on people in Scotland of a proposed cut. Will you, in addition to looking at your economic impact case, look at the impact that it will have on the poorest sections of society versus the most well-off? Will you look at the impact that this policy, your policy intent, will have on those different groups of people in Scotland?
Well, obviously, any financial decision that the government takes has to and should rightly take into account those kind of considerations. But it wouldn't be just a matter of what's raised by way of the tax. I think we also have to reflect on the economic benefits that would come from growth, whether that's new routes, sustaining routes, supporting our airports. Mr. Bibby partly covers Glasgow Airport, as I do, to declare an interest in that. It's in my own constituency. But there are wider benefits, of course, to supporting our airports and the employment that that brings as well. So I think there's many aspects to the policy, but clearly in determining a tax and potentially a tax reduction, that has to be considered as part of the government's overall spending plans.
In terms of the research, you talked about the research that you've looked at. The ONS have suggested that plans to cut APD in half would save the top 20% of earners £73 compared to the poorest would save just £4.50. And the Civil Aviation Authority have previously identified that the income, the mean income of those who fly from Aberdeen, Glasgow, Edinburgh and Inverness is higher than £40,000. Are you aware of those reports? Is that part of your thinking in terms of reflecting on all the research that is available?
Yeah, I've looked through a number of the reports, but I say again that I don't think you can just view the policy. And I know we're going beyond the legislation to set the tax into what you would make the rates potentially and where the reduction would be distributed potentially. But I think you have to look more widely at all the economic benefits of the policy. If it generates economic growth, who benefits from that wider economic growth? There's a full spectrum of employment opportunities at an airport, for example. And say not all airports are in the strong position of Edinburgh and Glasgow. I think it's a fair comment. So you have to look at everything in the round whilst making a determination on the rates, yes.
And finally, in terms of, you mentioned earlier the example of Republic of Ireland, the impact in the Republic of Ireland. Have you also looked at the effect that had on money going to the public purse in Republic of Ireland as part of your research?
It's funny that you should mention it, Mr. Bibby. The first meeting I had one of the first meetings I had when I was in post was a flurry of meeting other finance ministers and a chancellor. And so I had the pleasure of meeting Pascal Donoghue, who was an Irish finance minister, more focused on public expenditure. I asked him about it because obviously interested in the tax decision there. And he absolutely believed it was the right economic thing to do and has supported their economy. That was their expenditure finance minister's view. But looking at the evidence, it certainly has been supported and did deliver further economic activity, which they believe in turn helped fuel their economy. Looking at the figures, since Ireland abolished its air tax in 2014, Dublin Airport achieved the highest rate of passenger growth of any major airport in Europe, with passenger numbers increasing by 15.4% in 2015 and a year-on-year increase of 13.4% in the first half of 2016. And I'm sure they would argue that that then led to further economic benefits and tax receipts that helped fuel the economy.
I think more information on that would be helpful.
Okay.
Marie.
Thank you, Convener. As you know, I represent the Highlands and Islands, and there has been, certainly from the environmentalists, a reasonable case put forward that supporting rail alternatives would be more environmentally friendly. But I represent a part of the country that doesn't really have rail alternatives, and there was some evidence put forward that the alternatives might not be so environmentally friendly. So a sole person driving a large car and getting a ferry is probably less environmentally friendly than a flight. I just wondered if you could give us your thoughts around that. I know, again, we're talking about the
But as a former transport minister, I'm very pro-rail. Clearly I am, and there's lots of benefits to it in terms of environmental impact. And domestically, of course, increasingly moving towards electrification as well. And there are subsidy issues around rail as well, but I'm absolutely pro-rail. But as finance minister, I can't just view the world through the prism of the central belt. And I think that's why the Highlands point is very well, and the Islands point is very well made, that not everyone has access to the central belt stations to get to London. So there's two points I make. First of all, absolutely taking a national perspective on this, aviation and air travel does give that level of connectivity that isn't otherwise there, which I do think is significant. And the second point is not everyone's destination necessarily or convenient from those parts of the country to other parts of the UK. So again, aviation gives different destinations and routes compared to rail as well. So I don't think this is a battle between, you know, rail or aviation, because it presents different opportunities to different parts of the country, and we mustn't view this solely through the, you know, prism of the Central Belt.
Thank you.
Liam, is that a supplementary to that?
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry, Patrick.
Which is, so you say, quite rightly, not all airports are in a similar situation to Edinburgh and Glasgow, and you don't want to view things through the prism of the Central Belt. So will you be, when you do your robust evidence gathering, will you be investigating the possibility of differentiated schemes for different areas and different airports, depending on your preferred outcomes and what their local needs are?
I think it's a very fair point to consider local needs, but the best way to achieve that is to design a national policy that serves local needs. It may be difficult to establish a national tax policy that can be segmented in that way, but the key point is, will we understand the needs of every part of the country in designing a policy? Yes, ultimately. So there's a different way to do that, but it has to be ultimately compliant and consistent and practical for operators to be able to administer. So what I'm trying to describe is, you do that by designing the right national policy rather than trying to have different policies for different part of the country, which is another way to do it, might not be compliant legally.
Thank you. Patrick.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. I think the idea is that now that everyone's got the plate spinning, my job is to make you drop one or two of them. Can I start with one of the first comments that you made? You said that in relation to the economic evidence, there was a range of reports and research out there. Can you tell us which ones you rely on?
Well, certainly I rely on the advice from officials that I've looked at them all to produce a consensus. So there's a range of reports here that I wouldn't pick and choose between them and say which one's more credible than the other, but they all inform government position. I don't think it would be right for me to give a hierarchy or prioritise.
So there isn't an economic projection about, for example, the number of jobs that you anticipate being created either in the aviation industry or induced employment in the wider economy. There isn't a projection that you consider reliable.
Well, I think that there seems to be a consensus around a few of the reports converging in some of their benefits. The PwC, York Aviation and Edinburgh Airport reports seem to have some consistency in the outputs, but no, I wouldn't pick any one individual report, having looked at a review of them all.
So the Scottish Government doesn't actually have a view about what level of employment would be generated or what level of economic activity would be generated by its current policy?
Well, each report has looked at the policy and arrived at what they think the economic benefits are. To be absolutely accurate, clearly that would, one of the determinants of that will be what operators do based on government policy, what they commit to by way of additional routes or sustaining routes or capacity.
And you don't know what will happen.
Whatever
there.
That happens to be. What I'm saying is they are now saying, well, until they know what the tax rates are, they can't give absolute certainty as to what they will do. Where the consensus is that any tax reduction, of course, the airlines would want the biggest reduction possible, will lead to more routes, more connections, more capacity, therefore more jobs, more economic growth. The extent to which that boils down to absolute numbers will be dependent on what the government proposes by way of a tax reduction and how that's distributed and when.
So you accept that claim about increased numbers of routes without question, even though, for example, in Northern Ireland, after abolishing their aviation tax, they have seen some routes simply shut down?
I think routes,
the tax rate doesn't change viability of the route itself.
I think it would change some. I think it would change the viability of some, clearly, because of, you know,
which ones?
Behaviour. Which ones in the future in Scotland? Mm. Well, I don't know which ones, because it would be hard to assess right now. But what I do know is, from the airlines and the airport's perspective, you know, some routes are doing very well. Some will change. Some were announced, I think, last week. Some will be successful, some won't. But the advice is that in trying to secure new routes to Scotland, we aren't as competitive because we have one of the highest taxes of its kind in the world. And that's a consideration for operators when they're looking as to where to locate new routes. Now, as I say, some airports have been quite successful of late, others not so. Some routes are successful, others not so. But in establishing new routes, the first thing that an operator would look at is the tax take. And therefore, it is a consideration in all of that. So, but it is hard to be formulaic on the outcome of a tax policy without having set the tax policy. But of course, that should be fully considered when we are determining the distribution on any reduction of how the tax is applied.
So you're still falling back on the advice coming from the industry who would like to pay less tax. Let's look at the issue of the tourism deficit. We know that tourism results in some people coming to Scotland and spending money, but it results in more money being spent by Scots who travel overseas and have holidays elsewhere and spend a larger amount of money. So, you know, there is a deficit there. Will your policy see that deficit go up or down?
Well, there's obviously economic return and people coming back when the routes are established. So there is economic return in that. And
the point is that a new route being established or a greater flow of traffic on an existing route will see money going in both directions. And at the moment we have a tourism deficit. Will that deficit go up or will it be reduced as a result of your tax changes?
Well, it's hard to say because I haven't proposed what the tax changes are. So you don't know what
the overall policy you've stated is a 50% reduction in the tax take over the course of this Parliament.
But to answer that, you're asking about what the impact will be on routes. Mm. So what I'm saying is there'll be more passengers, more capacity, and more routes. Surely that, and Patrick Harvey as an internationalist would welcome more international connections opening up to the world so that there is that engagement and ability to travel. But we believe it will generate more economic growth for Scotland.
You believe that, but you're still not citing any evidence to demonstrate it.
Well, you're asking me to cite evidence on what routes will change as a consequence of the tax policy that I haven't set out.
OK, let's look at the fiscal impact then, the impact on the public purse. We've heard some evidence.
I think there were, just before we go there, I know that, because some of the questions that Ash had were around routes issues. Can we complete that bit?
Of course.
And then we can come back to your fiscal bit. But so I think both Ash and Willie both had questions in that area. So if we could just exhaust that just now, and then we can come back to the fiscal impacts. So Ash, do you want to kick off?
Sure. I think the new routes idea is quite key in terms of the economic impact. So I've got a friend who travels regularly for business and often finds it really difficult to find direct flights from Edinburgh to whichever European destination going to, which means they have to take two flights. They have to go via Heathrow to get wherever they're going. So obviously that's not great from an environmental perspective, and it's not particularly great from a business perspective. EY, I think it was last year, they brought out their a report, and they said for foreign direct investment, that this idea of regional connectivity is an important factor when businesses are making their investment decisions. So I'm just trying to get to the bottom. Is this, you know, a main thrust of the government's policy? Is this an objective that rather than, say, competing with, say, Newcastle Airport, what we're actually trying to do is compete with maybe Stockholm or Copenhagen for new routes?
Yeah, I think that's a key point. First of all, there has to be a benefit, and I'm not trying to prejudice where any reduction might be distributed, but there's clear economic benefit in getting access to hub airports because that then unlocks so many other opportunities and destinations. So absolutely focusing on the opportunities are both direct flights, but direct flights to hub airports for all the connections that that brings. And I think there is a view that this is just about competing with other UK airports. It's not. It's actually about competing with airports like Dublin or Stockholm or Lisbon or Barcelona. So it is about ensuring that we're able to attract the airlines to provide routes to Scotland. So the competition is, as you describe, much wider than that.
So obviously recently Ryanair just announced that they were going to, as a result of this policy, we were thinking about bringing 15 new routes to Scotland. What sort of expectations can we have around, you know, whether those routes will be long-term decisions?
Well, the issue, I suppose, of airlines, and particularly within Europe, and particularly with some operators, they can be quite adept and flexible. Therefore, the more competitive we are, the better to attract those kind of operators with the access that they have. And some of those short-haul European routes are, how can we describe, easier to change than others that maybe have a longer term or a longer decision-making period, and then implementation and sustainability. But clearly, government would want new routes to be sustained, and part of this policy approach will be to try and retain what we've got.
Okay, so final question. If we're talking about the economic impact for Scotland, and that's what the objective is, to increase that in a positive way, how will we judge if this policy has been successful?
Well, you could judge it through the government's economic strategy, but in terms of international connectiveness, it's more routes, more passengers, more economic growth, more destinations reached through Scotland's airports, and sustaining what we've got. That could be a judgment of success.
Okay, thank you.
On that specific point, the Chartered Institute of Taxation suggested there should be some form, and evidence we received from them, there should be some form of monitoring available to assess whether the outcomes intended by the bill actually delivered the policy memorandum's objectives. Is that something the government would consider?
Yeah, I think that would be a helpful point to consider an evaluation of what the fiscal policy has achieved by way of economic output, yes. I mean, there'll be the environmental assessment as well, of course, but yeah, I'm very open-minded to that evaluation of tax policy and intervention.
It's obviously something we can reflect on when we come to writing a report. Willie, you were in the same sort of area as
I. Yeah, thanks very much, Bruce. Cabinet Secretary, it's just to fly you briefly down to Prestwick for a wee moment. We did hear in previous committees that there was some evidence from Ireland about the positive impact in the regional airports in Ireland, and you mentioned just a moment ago the strong increase in passenger numbers at Dublin. And when I attended a meeting at the British-Irish Parliamentary Assembly in 2014, Michael O'Leary, Ryanair's chief exec, said quite clearly on record he could double the passenger numbers coming through Prestwick were the tax to go completely, and that would be only on the London and Belfast routes, he said at the time. Now, given what we've said already, if you do and if you are asked to conduct any kind of analysis for the committee, could you make sure that there's some kind of regional impact assessment for airports like Prestwick so that we might be able to see the positive benefits that we might be looking forward to at that airport?
Obviously, convener, and I respect members' interest in Prestwick, but we're trying to support the sustainability of the overall sector. And yes, when we're looking at the issue, it's back to Liam Kerr's point about what is the local circumstance and impact as well. So these are all matters that we would consider in arriving at a decision on the tax policy. But I'm very well aware of Ryanair's operation at Prestwick and the comments that they've made in the press around what they would do if APD was reduced.
Is there any more hard detail from Ireland about that impact in the regional airports? Because it's been mentioned several times, although we didn't hear the particular evidence presented to us or sent. Is there any hard data there that can give us an indication of what was happening in the regional economy in Ireland as a result of the tax going?
Can we ask you what further information we can provide to you?
Thank you. Thanks very much. Thanks,
Bruce. Okay, Patrick, back to the fiscal stuff. I've got a number of folk who want to get in still. But
yep. Several of the reports that you cited, Cabinet Secretary, claim that there'll be a benefit to the public purse through increased taxation in other areas, reducing this tax, generates other forms of economic activity which contribute to tax take. Do you agree with that, and have you achieved an answer to the question that, for example, Edinburgh Airport were not able to answer to the committee, what proportion of that induced taxation will be paid to the Scottish Government in devolved taxes and what proportion to the UK Government in reserve taxes?
No, Mr. Harvey, no, I don't have an answer to that, but it's a fair question. But I tell you why it's not a reason for not doing anything, though, that in areas where the Scottish Government might make an intervention to support the economy, the Scottish Government doesn't always get the tax receipt from it. But that in itself doesn't mean that we shouldn't make the right decision to grow our economy. But no, I don't have the analysis of what would go to the Chancellor of the Exchequer and what would come to the Scottish Government. As I say, the economic consensus is that it delivers greater economic growth, but I don't have such a breakdown.
So even if the government's policy objective is fulfilled and you see the kind of economic activity that you would like to see generated, you don't know whether that will make public finances in the Scottish Government in a stronger position or a weaker position?
Because of the nature, as Mr. Harvey's aware, of the block grant adjustment, we know specifically, once it's being raised, what the return would be for the Scottish Government on a policy just on air departure tax. Mm. But you know, it would be hard for me to determine what share of other taxes we would benefit from. If it improves employment, of course, there would be income tax. We'll have assignment of VAT in due course. But you know, it would be hard to break that down. And to try and give a figure now would also, again, preempt my point around setting the tax rates, which would then, I think, more adequately inform such an analysis.
Income tax was one of the elements I was going to ask about. The three studies that you cited as having some reliability did attempt to put figures on, for example, income tax being generated, but they seem to be based on out-of-date income tax rates, bands and personal allowance. Has the Scottish Government attempted to update that work, given, for example, how much above the personal allowance induced employment generated in the hospitality sector might be?
Not specifically, and I make the point again because I think that that's preempting what the tax rates might be.
Mm. Which, you know, still for me reinforces this notion that you're asking us to pass a bill which doesn't place any requirements or constraints on ministers for the issues that they must consider in proposing rates and bans. Can I come on to the environmental aspects?
No, I can't say you want to respond.
Yeah, just that I don't agree with that, because what I've said already at committee is I think that there should be economic and environmental consideration, you know, in advance and as we put our tax position across. So what I'm asking Parliament to consider right now is the ability to raise the tax.
So you'd be open to placing those requirements onto the face of the bill?
I've given a commitment to what information I think the government could provide. The SEA is certainly a requirement which we're duty-bound to deliver in any event.
Mm. And I would prefer that that was conducted before a policy like a 50% cut in APD was adopted. I would prefer that we looked at that analysis, the economic, the social and the environmental analysis, and then decided what the policy should be rather than deciding on a policy and then going looking for evidence to support it.
No, I think, well, we're into the realms not of just what government's proposed and what political parties have proposed in a manifesto and why we've reached the decisions that we have. And as I say, there is evidence that this supports economic growth, but I'm saying it's a dynamic situation because of international events, because of public expenditure, because of the dynamics of Parliament. There are a range of things that come into play. What I'm accurately doing is outlining the steps that we'll take before I put tax proposition to members, and you're asking me specifically about the evidence that should rightly be considered before we take those, and I'm being as open as possible on how that's presented to Parliament through committee in a due process.
Yet you already have a policy decided, a 50% reduction in APD over the course of this
because month. This government does believe there is...
Made that point, Patrick.
Okay. So, the environmental aspects. We've had a letter from one of your officials, from the Deputy Director of the Fiscal Responsibility Division, following our first evidence session, who tells us that the Scottish Government has made use of an energy modelling system to assess how effort on carbon reduction is best shared across sectors of the economy. Is there then a view in the Scottish Government about what share of that effort should fall to the aviation sector?
Sorry, in terms of environmental effort?
Carbon reduction, yeah.
Yeah, we have set out a climate change plan. We recognise that there's increased emissions potentially as a consequence of this policy, so we have to work harder in other areas, and we'll produce the SEA on our policy proposition.
Sorry, I was asking quite a specific question. The statement is the energy modelling system assesses how effort is best shared across sectors of the economy. I'm asking whether the Scottish Government has a view about the share of that effort that should fall to the aviation sector. Effectively, the UK Climate Change Committee thinks that aviation emissions should be capped at 2005 levels by 2050. The aviation industry says that it can halve emissions from that 2005 baseline by 2050. Whether we regard their efforts as credible in that regard or not, that's what they say they can do. Does the Scottish Government have a policy on what aviation emissions can be, how much they can be allowed to grow?
As Mr. Harvey knows, I have responsibility for fiscal policy. I'm happy to engage with the Environment Secretary and report back on the wider environmental view on that. But I'm cited on the statistics.
You've surely done that before this point in the bill.
Yes, well, I'll say the Environment Secretary has lead responsibility for environmental matters. You're asking
so what did they say?
More deeply. So that's what I'm saying. I'll return to you with Rosanna Cunningham's position on the apportionment of climate change emission contributions.
You haven't asked?
Well, Mr. Harvey, I was able to outline a position. You want me to go through in more detail the position on the environment? I can do that.
Doing my best to give you the chance to do so, yes.
Yes, well, I covered in my statement earlier, Convener, if you wish me to continue, that we recognise...
Enough of this going back and forward between the two of you in this regard at this stage, so I'm just going to stop that particular conversation at this stage. Have you got anything else you want to ask him?
Yes. The same letter says that the Scottish Government is prepared to work harder in other areas based on the increased aviation emissions. Can you tell us what that preparation has been?
Well, as Mr. Harvey knows, we've taken the climate change plan to Parliament. We've got a number of proposals, recommendations as what we do to reduce emissions across transport, housing, agriculture, energy efficiency, decarbonisation of the transport system generally. So there are a range of policies for us to meet our statutory targets on the environment, and we recognise that even with some of the progress that's been made within aviation around fuel efficiency and technology, there's only so far that will take us. But recognising if there is growth in the sector, then there are more emissions, it has to be within an area that's tolerable to the Scottish Government. And the contribution that increased emissions might make as a consequence of this policy could amount to an increase of around 3% in aviation emissions, which is 0.1% in the total Scottish emissions. So the Committee on Climate Change, which has looked at this, has advised that any increase in emissions from reducing APD is likely to be manageable. And we have published a draft climate change plan which does set out how the government proposed to meet its statutory emission reduction targets under the Act in 2009. So as I say, there's a range of actions in other portfolios and sectors which contribute to our environmental case, as well as looking at the strategic environmental assessment to see what else can be done, and also what ultimately decisions we arrive at by way of tax rates.
Your answer there, nor the draft climate change action plan, tells us what actions are going to be necessary in other sectors to pull the weight that aviation isn't being required to pull because it's being given a free ride on climate change.
But it gives the overall targets on climate change and what we're doing in the other sectors to meet those targets, which are statutory targets, of course.
You don't worry at all that your comparisons with Ireland, for example, and the economic benefit that they feel that they've got will leave us in the same position that Ireland is in. They have less ambitious climate change targets, and at last report I can find they're failing to meet them.
No, I don't believe that it'll undermine our climate change targets. No, I don't.
What's the basis for that belief?
I think...
Patrick, come on. I think you've had a fair
there's
crack.
There's nothing here.
You've had a fair crack at the whip on this, I think. In regard to this particular end, we're just going back to a ding-dong again, and it's not really getting us anywhere. So I'm going to move on to exemptions, and Adam.
Thank you. You may or may not be relieved, Cabinet Secretary, to learn I don't want to ask you about economic impact. I don't want to ask you about environmental assessment either. I want to ask you about something in the bill itself, or other not in the bill itself. And just so I'm clear that I've understood this correctly, tax bans are not legislated for in the bill, tax rate amounts are not legislated for in the bill, and tax exemptions are not legislated for in the bill. Is that correct? So why have you taken the judgment, Cabinet Secretary, not to legislate for tax exemptions specifically on the face of the bill? And why have you taken that judgment when tax exemptions are, as I understand it, on the face of the legislation in the current APD legislation, and also on the face of the legislation in the LBTT legislation, which this Parliament passed in the last session?
No, I think they're very good questions, Convener. The specific reason is to have that consistency, to be flexible and the ability to adapt. And I should set out it's the government's intention to match the current exemptions for passengers. I mean, we've said ministers have previously agreed to retaining all the current UK APD exemptions under ADT. But the difference between... As Mr. Tompkins will be well aware, the Scottish legislation and what might be done at Westminster's. Westminster has a finance bill every year where, I mean, it's something worthy of consideration, of course, by the Scottish Parliament, and the Budget Review Group may well conclude that. But because we don't have that legislative route every year to change elements of finance policy or legislative policy, I would rather go through, and it's more appropriate to go through secondary legislation to change elements like that. It's not fundamental to the operation of the bill or the tax, but it might be something we would want as a parliament, the flexibility to change tax rates and also exemptions. I mean, you could take a view on whether it's right, exemptions in the past have been part of that primary legislation, but enabling power for ministers and parliament to consider it is, I think, far more appropriate because it's far more flexible to change the circumstances. So let's say the UK government did something by way of exemptions and we felt it was important to replicate that in Scotland. I just feel on behalf of the government, indeed the Parliament, that we should have the ability to do that without returning to primary legislation with all the stages that that requires, but still has maximum parliamentary scrutiny through that secondary legislation. So on rates and bans, that does feature more with land and building transaction tax and landfill tax, the currently devolved taxes to Scotland. But I think exemptions should be secondary for the exact same reason that we should have that flexibility and ability to adapt.
Are you going to make the same change to LBTT? Are you going to take the exemptions out of the primary legislation and put them in regulations so that you can have more flexibility?
I think, well, there's a suggestion in that. I'm not proposing to do that, actually, but...
So what's the difference between... This is what I'm struggling to understand. Yeah. Is like, why is it... why does having the exemptions on the face of the primary legislation with regard to LBTT give you enough flexibility, but putting those exemptions on the face of this bill would somehow not give you enough flexibility? I don't understand...
It's a matter of fact that it doesn't give us the same flexibility. I'm not suggesting we revisit land building transaction tax or Scottish landfill tax. Mainly on LBTT, the exemptions feel pretty static, and it may well be that the exemptions for passengers for air departure tax is fairly static, like, you know, children under 16 on a date of travelling in economy class. Feels like something that's not about to change, but maybe some of the other exemptions might be subject to change. UK government has, if they consider a change here, they could do it through the finance bill, essentially, in the House of Commons. I don't have that ability.
It might be helpful, Cabinet Secretary, if you could give us a table of all of the changes to exemptions, both with regard to passenger exemptions and aircraft exemptions that have occurred at UK level since the introduction of this tax, so that we can see how frequently this flexibility is in practice required. Okay. I don't know what the data on that will show, but it would be. I mean, there's a concern, a twofold concern, I think. First, that, you know, effective parliamentary scrutiny is important irrespective of the kind of legislation that we're talking about. But we all know, I think, that the most effective parliamentary scrutiny comes with primary legislation, and that all forms of secondary legislation have secondary levels of parliamentary scrutiny. But there's also a point about legal certainty and the rule of law. And yes, it's a fast-moving situation, particularly with regard to changing needs of Scottish connectivity post-Brexit and all of that. But nonetheless, even fast-moving areas of government regulation have to be subject to the rule of law. And the way in which we subject government discretion to the rule of law is by having as much as possible in primary legislation, and not the other way around, not having as much as possible in the hands of the discretion of ministers. You'd accept all of that, wouldn't you?
I think some of that is deliberately provocative, but based on a premise that Parliament should have scrutiny of those functions, I absolutely accept that. And I wouldn't describe statutory instruments as escaping, ministers escaping the duty to attend to Parliament or make a case, whether it was negative or affirmative. You know, I appear at committees for full scrutiny, and the Parliament, its committees in the chamber, full Parliament can decide what to do with it. So. I'm not asking executive order here. I'm asking for statutory instruments to give us the ability to change. Executive order might be a totally different debate that we would be having. And maybe Mr. Tompkins' case would have been stronger.
I'm not accusing you of replicating the style of administration.
I'm glad to hear it. That might have been one of the plates that Mr. Harvey was trying to encourage me to drop.
But I'm just trying to understand the extent to which, Cabinet Secretary, it is necessary for you and your ministerial colleagues to have this flexibility to change not the bands and the rates, but the very shape of the tax. But the exemptions are qualitatively different from bans and rates. Bans and rates are about how much is liable. Exemptions are about who is liable to pay and in respect of what. That's a substantive and qualitative difference. My own view is that we haven't heard enough about why it's necessary to put those exemptions into secondary instruments rather than on the face of this legislation when that hasn't happened with regard to UK legislation on air passenger duty, and when it didn't happen with regard to LBTT in this Parliament. So anything further you can help us with in those regards would be helpful.
I'll happily provide a comparison where we can and say one of the key reasons, or two key reasons for doing this, to remain competitive, I think we have to have the ability to be able to change and do that through due process, but if we so choose to do, through statutory instrument. But the second point is you asked deliberately why the difference in APD. As I say again, the UK government has the, I'm not sure I would describe it as the luxury of a finance bill, but the ability to take amendments through a finance bill, which has its own process in Westminster, in a way that I don't necessarily have here. So that was my first point, and I'll happily provide more on that. But the second point is just in considering the tax rates in the round, you know, there might be a better way of delivering some of the exemptions through that as well. So again, it's just about having the ability to produce not just good primary legislation, but good legislation that delivers on outcomes as well. So there may be a better way to do things that the committee can explore.
I may have missed some other areas of folks who've got some questions. Liam, have you still got a supplementary you want to do?
A small one arising from Ash Denham's question earlier on, which is, you're obviously making a direct link between reducing the tax and an increase in flights, an increase in operators. So you mentioned EasyJet and Ryanair. And the thought in my mind is, what modelling are you doing? What evidence are you taking to foresee the impact of, let's say, you bring in a 50% reduction and the Westminster government immediately says, well, OK, we will bring in a 50% reduction. Does that ruin the scheme? Does that negate any positive impact, in your view?
I think it's a fair point that one of the drivers for this, well, the policy intent, is to make Scotland more competitive, to give us that advantage, because it is one of the highest taxes of its kind in the world, certainly the highest in Europe, and we want to put Scotland in a stronger economic position. We want to improve our international connectivity, and the airlines and the airports are supportive of this. We would obviously have to revisit our decisions year to year around what we would do with air departure tax based on a number of factors around, public spending plans, economic opportunities, the evaluation of what the policy is achieving, and taken in light of what other airports and airlines would be facing. So yes, we will have to analyse all of that before we set out our proposition to Parliament on the tax rates and then keep that under review. Every year, UK Chancellor could change the position on APD, and every year Scotland could look to respond or not, as the case may be.
Yes. I thought earlier you told this Cabinet Secretary this wasn't really about an issue between, for instance, Newcastle and Edinburgh, but more about Stockholm, Lisbon, Barcelona. In which case, if that was the case, then what the Chancellor did at the UK Treasury would have less real impact than what our decisions were here, if that's where the competition we're talking about, is it? Or have I got that wrong?
Of course, there's the magic words spoken in the Finance Committee, block grant adjustment. And the reason I make the point is whatever we do, of course, is relative to what the UK government does to arrive at our outcome of our figures through the block grant adjustment. Liam Kerr's point was specifically around what do we do to respond to Chancellor's position, which is, you know, we'll obviously inform our own. But, Convener, you rightly make the point. This is not about competition with just other UK airports. This is about competition with international airports, about securing routes to and from Scotland and sustaining what we've got. But we mustn't forget that, yes, this is part of the block grant adjustment.
Neil, you still got a question outstanding? I can't remember. Passengers' issues.
Well, it was just, if I may, just briefly, when you answered Ash Denham's question about what would be the measure of success, you said more passengers, more flights, more operators. Is there any, obviously one is more, one passenger more, one flight more. Is there not any, you know, more specifics in terms of what a measure of success will be? Is it?
Well, I don't know if the committee want me to break it down to absolute number of passengers, absolute number of flights, what's sustained, and
just roughly.
Well, I've described it as, you know, contributing to generally more, but I think this will be, I suppose, better informed, as I've said repeatedly this morning, once we set out the tax rates, which flows from the government's economic strategy. That will then allow greater certainty from the operators as to how they'll respond. As I say, two in particular have outlined what it would mean for them in increasing their presence in Scotland by way of routes and capacity. But once we are able to outline our tax proposition, then that should inform the airlines of what's proposed and how they respond by way of growth.
I think you can take it as read from what we've heard around the table today that the committee will be asking you, at least I'm making an assumption here, to carry out that independent economic assessment, because a lot of what the questions that were actually are germane to that bit of work being carried out. So I don't think you should wait, if I'm seeing heads nodding around the table, for our report. I think you should assume that's going to be in it, so that we can actually begin to answer some of these questions that were around here.
Democracy.
Well, that's me applying my executive order. Okay. Let's watch my haircut in future. That concludes this particular part of evidence taken on the ADT this morning. I'm now going to suspend the meeting to allow a changeover of witnesses. Colleagues, we begin with the second item on today's agenda, which is to consider a Scottish statutory instrument relating to modifications to the Scottish Fiscal Commission remit. Before we come to the motion seeking our approval at agenda item 3, we have an evidence session on the order. Again, we are joined for this session by the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Constitution, and John St Clair, who is the Senior Principal Legal Officer. We're also joined by David Kerrouchi, have I got that right, David? Scottish Government Policy Advisor. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting and invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. My opening statement also moves it. Hopefully it can cover off both in a technical way. Anyway, I'll return to your guidance. So I beg to move that the draft Scottish Fiscal Commission Modification of Functions Regulations 2017 laid before Parliament on the 27th of January now be considered. These regulations expand the functions of the Scottish Fiscal Commission to reflect the powers devolved through the Scotland Act 2016 and the Fiscal Framework Agreement between the Scottish and UK governments. Excuse me. In summary, the functions of the Commission are expanded as follows. The addition of a function to prepare forecasts of demand-led social security expenditure, and the addition of a function to require the Commission to prepare Scottish GDP forecasts, but not covering the value of oil, gas and other hydrocarbons produced in the Scottish sector of UK continental shelf. These additional functions will take effect when the Scottish Fiscal Commission Act 2016, which I'll refer to as the 2016 Act, commences on the 1st of April. The 2016 Act was passed by the Scottish Parliament on 10th of March 2016, prior to the Scotland Act 2016 gaining royal assent. It was therefore not possible for the Scottish Parliament to legislate for the devolved social security forecasting during the bill process. The Commission will also produce forecasts of the Scottish onshore GDP. This is important as under the Fiscal Framework Agreement, the Scottish Parliament has been given additional resource borrowing powers. These additional powers are in part to assist the management of any additional risks and volatility associated with the further fiscal devolution in the 2016 Scotland Act. These powers come into play if onshore Scottish GDP falls below certain trigger points. As the committee will be aware, I laid the Scottish Fiscal Commission Act 2016 commencement and transitory provision regulations 2016 last year, which, amongst other things, brought the Commission into statutory existence for the purpose of ministers consulting with the Commission prior to amending its functions. This is a condition in Section 8 of the 2016 Act. As such, I wrote to Lady Rice, Chair of the Commission, on the 9th of November, and the Commission responded positively to our draft amendments.
Okay. Is any member got any questions for the Cabinet Secretary? No members indicate any questions. So therefore, move to agenda item 3, which is consideration of the motion on the order. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move motion S5M03911 that the Finance and Constitution Committee recommends that the Scottish Fiscal Commission bracket modification of functions bracket regulations 2017 draft be approved.
I move.
And do members have any further comments? No further comments, I may put the question. The question is that motion S5M03911 be agreed to. Are all agreed? We're agreed. That takes us next item on the agenda is to consider a Scottish statutory instrument which seeks to revise the landfill tax rates and bans for 2017-18. Before we come to the motion seeking our approval on agenda item, again, we're joined. We have an evidence-taking session and we're joined with the same people as previously. Cabinet Secretary, do you wish to make an opening statement?
I do, thank you, Convener. The Scottish Landfill Tax Standard Rate and Lower Rate Order 2017 specifies the standard rate and lower rate for the Scottish Landfill Tax as I've previously set out in the budget. These proposed rates ensure that the tax increases in line with inflation and matches the planned UK landfill tax rates for 2017-18 as provided in the Finance Act 2015. In setting these rates, I'm acting to avoid any potential for waste tourism through material differences between the tax rates north and south of the border. In addition, I'm providing appropriate financial incentives to support the delivery of our ambitious waste and circular economy targets, including our zero waste goal that no more than 5% of total waste should go to landfill by 2025. The Scottish Government forecasts it will generate revenue of £149 million from the Scottish Landfill Tax in 2017-18, and this full year forecast has again been endorsed as reasonable by the Scottish Fiscal Commission.
Any members got any questions on this particular instrument? Patrick.
Thanks very much. Cabinet Secretary, we're considering this at the very last possible moment, as far as I understand. If the committee wasn't able to reach a view this morning, then we wouldn't be able to have a motion brought to the chamber this week, and it would fail to reach the 28-day cut-off point. Without wanting to get into the reasons why we're here, and it's clearly in relation to an instrument which I don't detect any objection to, I wonder if you could share your thoughts on how we can avoid this kind of situation happening again in the future, particularly if we are looking at the range of tax powers that are out there now in the Scottish Government, some of which are more contentious than this one. How can we ensure that we avoid more delicate, more dangerous last-minute processes than this in future?
Convener, I'm very happy to give that further consideration. So this will be set for the year, where again, Budget Review Group will help us navigate our way through some of these process issues. I'm happy to give that further consideration. It's not the intention of government for you to feel that way around engagement on this, because actually I think there's some positives in this in how it aligns with our environmental strategy. And a further positive within that is the credit rate for the Scottish Landfill Communities Fund, which is more generous than the UK equivalent. So I just make the point that this is certainly worthy of further consideration. I'm happy to give thought as to how we can ensure that there's a more meaningful timetabling in future. And I know that Budget Review Group will be looking at all of these matters for the total budget process, but I'm happy to give it a further thought.
Thank you.
And there are no further questions? There are no further questions. In that case, we now move to agenda item 5, which is consideration of the motion on the order. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to remove motion S5M03895 that the Finance and Constitution Committee recommends that the Scottish Landfill Tax Bracket Standard Rate and Lower Rate Bracket Order 2017 be approved.
Move.
The members have any further comments? No further comments. In that case, we are agreed. We will now produce a short report on both of these orders to the Parliament, setting out our decision. Sorry, I should have asked, do you all agree? I'd make an assumption, but we're agreed. Again, we'll now publish a short report on both of these orders, setting out our decisions. Thank you. That's the last item on agenda. I now close this meeting of the committee.